नमस्कार। नाउ वी विल सी द सेकंड प्रैक्टिकल ऑफ हॉस्पिटल एंड क्लिनिकल फार्मेसी सब्जेक्ट, दैट इज टू प्रिपेयर एंड इवेल्युएट वाटर फॉर इंजेक्शन IV। द वर्ड IP इंडिकेट्स दैट इज इट इज अकॉर्डिंग टू Indian Pharmacopoeia, that is the official book of India. There are some instructions which you have to follow while enter into the laboratory or while conducting the hospital and clinical pharmacy practical and experiments. Instructions are official instructions, standard operating instructions, and some common sense topics. Before conducting the experiment, we have to know some concepts or some points or some definitions. Like first, the water for injection for IV. It is a pyrogenic distilled water intended for use in the preparation of medicines for parenteral administration. It is most extensively used vehicle in parenteral formulations. It is well tolerated by body and ionizable electrolytes readily dissolves in water. The water miscible co-solvents such as glycerin and propylene glycol are used as vehicles in small volume parenteral fluids. They are used to increase the solubility of drugs and to stabilize drugs degraded by hydrolysis. Metabolization oils are used to dissolve the drugs that are insoluble in water. For example, steroids, hormones, and vitamins are dissolved in vegetable oils. These formulations are administered by intramuscular injections. The major considerations in vehicle selections are solubility, stability, and safety. You have observed various materials or various salines and various injections. Some injections are made up with the water, or you can directly use that injections to pour into the body or inject into the body. Some injections you have to made by mixing a water for injection or given liquid into a solid powder which is into the vials. Have you seen such injections? Specifically, or majority of that injections are having examples like some antibiotic injections which are come into the powder form. When or at the time of use, you have to mix particular water into that powder, shake well, dissolve that powder, and then inject that injections. And some injections are hard or maybe called as oily injections, which you have to take on your hip side or intramuscular portions. These are known as intramuscular injections. There are some additives present, or you can add, or the injectables or the products having some additives. They are the solutes of highest purity. These solutes may be sterile and pyrogen free. Their purpose is to produce a safe and elegant product. Various additives such as antimicrobial agents, antioxidants, buffers, chelating agents, and tonicity adjusting agents are included into the injection formulations. The drug substances. After considering the water for injection solutes, the drug substances added to the transfusion fluids are the next important raw materials, like carbohydrates, polyols, amino acids, lipid emulsions, electrolytes and so on. These raw materials should be highly pure. IP 1996 recommended special test for the above raw materials when they are intended to the use for the preparations of intravenous infusions. Amongst the above listed, that is the carbohydrate, polyols, amino acids, you have some test, that is the stability test or suitability test. We will conduct some test and some experiments into this curriculum. The containers and the closures for the parenterals, as the additives and the vehicle is important, the containers and closures also important into the parenterals. The containers and closures that are used for the packaging parenterals product must be maintain the sterility of the packed fluids, withstand the sterilization, compatible with the packed fluid or material, and allow withdrawal of the content. These are some standard requirement from that container or the closure material. The large volume parenterals fluids are packed into the glass bottles, PVC collapsible bags, and semi-rigid polythene containers. The glass bottles. Glass bottles are commonly used container for the transfusion fluids or the transfusion bottles. In the previous era or the in the previous years, up to some last 10 to 15 years, the glass bottles are widely used as a saline bottles. You can see these saline bottles in the old films, which are about 1960s, 70s, 50s and so on. You can see the glass bottles for the use or the transfusion of the blood in some movies. Okay, you can get some ideas. Nowadays, there are some specific injectables or the parenterals which are given into the glass bottles into the government hospitals also. Government hospital till using this type of containers. There are some types of the glass which are used into as a container for the parenteral preparations. Type 1st, type 2nd, type 3rd and NP, that is non-parenteral. These types may be asked into the exams, into the theory exams as well as into practical exams also. So type 1st glass is used for the buffered and unbuffered aqueous solutions and all other uses. That is the highly resistant borosilicate glass, type 1st. Type 2nd is treated soda lime glass, which is used for the buffered aqueous solutions with the pH below 7 for the dry powders and oleaginous solutions. These are packed into the type 2nd glass. Type 3rd glass, which is soda lime glass. It is used for dry powders and oleaginous solutions. The type 4 or type NP is general purpose soda lime glass. It is not for the parenterals. This type or NP type is not used for the parenterals, and it is used for the tablets, oral solutions, suspensions, ointments and external liquids. These are the types of glass bottles. What are the advantages? There are some advantages. That is, the glass is transparent and chemically inert. They are having the high chemical resistance and resist the actions of the water, acid, bases, salts, etc. They can be easily cleaned due to their smooth surface. They are allow checking for the clarities. They are rigid, strong and withstand for the sterilization. What are the disadvantages of glass bottles? These are heavier than the plastic bottles and therefore less transportable. They are brittle and subject to damage during the transport and the storage. During use, they required use of an air inlet filter device for the pressure equilibrium within the container. A further problem with the glass containers that may occur during the moist heat sterilization. This results into the contamination. For overcoming these disadvantages, the PVC collapsible bags can be used. These are used for the most packaging infusion fluids. They are designed with the port for the attachment of administration set and an additives port for the addition of small volume parenteral fluids. What are the advantages? These are resistance to impact and flexible collapsible during fluid administration, so do not require any air inlet system. Now, what are the disadvantages? They permit a high moisture penetration. They absorb some type of the drugs. They require the extended sterilization time due to the heat resistance. And most heat sterilization requires air ballasting to avoid the pouch explosions. These are having some disadvantages. There are also having a third type, that is the semi-rigid plastic containers. Okay, they are used for the volume of 100 ml for the electrolyte solutions, 3 liter for the total parenteral nutrition solutions, and up to 5 liter for dialysis solutions. The semi-rigid containers are more drug compatible than PVC containers. They are difficult to break. They do not fully collapse and needs extended heat sterilization times. They needs the air equilibrium like the glass bottles. The closure up to while rubber closure are the most suitable for the various containers like glass and plastic as well. They are used to seal the openings of the cartridges, vials and bottles, providing a material soft and elastic enough to permit the entry and withdrawal of a hypodermic needle without loss of integrity of the sealed containers. These are the diagrams of glass containers, flexible plastic containers, and a typical set or the administration set, which is having various parts, the filter, the knob, the adjustable knob, etc. We will go for the second experiment, that is to prepare and evaluate the water for injection. We have seen the prior concepts like water. Now we will having the types of water and distillation process. Water for injection is a pyrogenic distilled water intended for use in the preparation of medicines for the parenteral administration when water is used as a vehicle and dissolving or diluting substances or the preparations for injectable preparations, that is the sterile water for injection. Compliance test for the water for injection, we will see one by one. What is the general structure? Potable water or the purified water, we will use distillation unit, we will make the water for injection, and we will test compliance as per the IP 1996. What are the learning objectives? Intellectual skill, you will understand the distillation method, you will discriminate the different types of water, and you will understand the distillation unit. What are the motor skills now? Ability to handle the instrument, ability to collect and preserve the water, and ability to interpret the states. There are some glassware and chemicals you have to use in this practical. This is a simple glass distillation unit which is used at the laboratory level. This is the old time, or this is the simple unit which will give the distilled water. The potable water or a tap water is taken, a purified water is taken into the round glass or round glass bottom. By heating, they collect the water is transported into the vapors. The vapors are condensed or cooled down with using the condenser, and that cooled water is now the water for injection. This is the distilled water. This is the manistee electrically heated automatic water still, or the Stokes still, which is used nowadays into the laboratory level. This is the stepwise procedure. Water for injection is obtained by using the distilled potable water or the purified water from a neutral glass, quartz or suitable metal still, which is filled with the effective device for preventing the entertainment of droplet. Okay. Take the sufficient quantity of the potable water or purified water in the metal water still or the glass distillation unit of the neutral glass. Boil the water using burner or electricity, allow to form the sufficient steam. Steam is condensed to water for injection using water condenser by distillation unit. The first 50 ml of the portion of the distilled is discarded and the remainder is collected in a suitable borosilicate container. Rinse the container with water for injection and then reject that water for injection. Continue the process and collect the distillate in a suitable borosilicate container. The water for injection should be used immediately for the evaluation as per the IP. Now we will see one by one. Test for acidity and alkalinity. For the acidity, take the 10 ml sample freshly boiled and cooled in a borosilicate glass flask or test tube. Add methyl red solution 0.05 ml. If the resulting solution is not red, acid absent. Same alkalinity, take 10 ml sample freshly boiled and cooled into the borosilicate glass flask or the test tube. Add 0.1 ml of bromothiol thymol blue solution. If the resulting solution is not blue, alkalinity is absent. We will see the first test. Test for acidity, for which we have to take 10 ml sample. We have taken the 10 ml sample freshly boiled and cooled into the flask or maybe into the test tube, in which we have to add 0.05 ml methyl red solution. We have this methyl red solution 0.0. We will shake it. The resulting solution should not be red. So this is not red. Acids are absent into this solution. We will conduct second test. Test for alkalinity. Again, we will take a 10 ml sample in which we will add 0.1 ml of bromothiol blue solution. We have this bromothiol blue solution and we will take it 0.1 ml. You can use the glass rod or the pipette also. Shake well.
we have to find perfect blue color or the blue color. This solution is not blue. So, alkaline substances or alkalinity is absent. These are two tests. Acidity, test for acidity, which resulting no red color, and alkalinity, which resulting no blue color.
Next is test for calcium and magnesium. For this test, you have to take 100 ml sample in borosilicate glass beaker, add 2 ml of ammonia buffer, which is having pH 10, 50 mg of mordant black second mixture, which is in solid state, and 0.5 ml of 0.01 molar disodium iodide, a pure blue color is produced.
Test for calcium and magnesium. For this, we will require the sample, a beaker or borosilicate glass beaker, the ammonium buffer, mordant black 2, which is solid, and 0.01 molar EDTA. Okay, we will take 100 ml sample into the flask. You can use measuring cylinder, or you can use the measuring or the readings which are already present on the beaker. 100 ml of this sample, we will add 2 ml of ammonium buffer. 2 ml. This is ammonium buffer. We have taken 2 ml and added into our sample. We will add mordant black to 50 mg. We will take approximately 50 milligram. Afterward, we will add 0.5 ml of 0.01 molar disodium iodide. As we are expecting the pure blue color, there is no pure blue color, means the calcium, magnesiums are absent. This is the distilled water or the water for injection, which is free from substances. Test for calcium and magnesium.
Now we will see the test for chlorides. To 10 ml sample in borosilicate beaker, add 1 ml of 2 molar nitric acid and 0.2 ml of 0.1 molar silver nitrate. The appearance of the solution does not change for at least 15 minutes.
Test for chloride. For this, we will require the sample, 2 molar nitric acid and 0.1 molar silver nitrate solution. For this, we will take 10 ml sample into the test tube, or you can use the beaker also. The 10 ml sample, in that we will going to add 1 ml of 2 molar nitric acid. Be careful while handling and using pipettes for sucking the chemicals. We will add this. And 0.2 ml of silver nitrate. You can see the appearance of that particular subject or appearance of this solution. We have to keep it for at least 15 minutes, and after 15 minutes we will see whether the appearance is changed or not. So we will wait for 15 minutes. Now 15 minutes are over and we will check. See this, there is no change into the appearance after or at least 15 minutes, means chlorides are absent. This is test for chloride. After or at least 15 minutes.
Now we will see test for sulfate. To 10 ml of sample in borosilicate beaker, add 0.1 ml of 2 molar hydrochloric acid and 0.1 ml of barium chloride solution. The appearance of the solution does not change for at least 1 hour. Test for sulfate.
test for sulfate. For this, we will require the sample, 2 molar of hydrochloric acid, 2 molar hydrochloric acid solution. You can see here, over here. And the barium chloride solution. Okay. Every time while using the chemicals, be careful and at least shake well before the use, so that it is in uniform. We will take the 10 ml sample. In that, 0.1 ml of 2 molar hydrochloric acid. Molar HCl. We will add 0.1 ml of barium chloride solution. For this test also, we have to look for the appearance of solution. You can see the appearance of solution. We have to keep it for 1 hour. So we will keep this test tube as it is for 1 hour. After 1 hour, we will see whether the appearance is changed or not. We have hold this test tube for 1 hour, and you can see there is no change into the appearance after or at least for 1 hour. Means sulfates are absent into these samples.
Next is test for oxidizable substances. Take 100 ml of sample in beaker, add 10 ml of 1 molar sulfuric acid and 0.1 ml of 0.02 molar potassium permanganate and boil for 5 minutes. The solution remains faintly pink. In this, remember the thing, boil for 5 minutes means after starting the boiling, you have to keep the solution 5 minutes. Okay, after starting the first bubble of the boiling, then count the 5 minutes. That is the exact time of 5 minutes. The 5 minutes mean doesn't means that we are starting the burner and count the 5 minutes. No, after starting the boiling, you have to count for the 5 minutes. Okay, we will see this test.
Test for oxidizable substances, for which we will require the sample. 1 molar H2SO4, that is sulfuric acid, and 0.02 molar KMnO4, that is potassium permanganate. First of all, we will take 100 ml of sample into beaker. You can use the measuring cylinder or you can use the measurings which are printed on the beaker also. 100 ml sample. We will add 10 ml of sulfuric acid. While measuring the chemicals or the acids with using the measuring cylinders, slightly tilt measuring cylinder so avoid the acids or chemicals which are coming on your hands. Maybe be careful while doing the practicals and handling the chemicals. We will add the sulfuric acid into the sample. Afterward, we will add 0.1 ml of KMnO4. We have to boil it for 5 minutes, and after 5 minutes the solution becomes or remains the faintly pink. So let's boil it. We have boiled the solution and you can see the color of that particular solution is faint pink or faintly pink. That color remains after the boiling. That means the taste of these oxidizable substances.
Now the test for residue on evaporation. For this test, we will evaporate 10 ml of sample to the dryness on water bath or directly into the porcelain dish. The residue weighs not more than 1 mg or 0.001%.
The test for residue and evaporation, for which we will require the burner, tripod, the porcelain dish and our sample. We will take 10 ml sample and pour it into the porcelain dish for evaporation. And we will enlight the burner. Now burner is on and you have to maintain the flame. So maintain the flame on which the boil can get the water is on boiling position. After complete dry, I will show you the residue on evaporation. So for complete drying, it will take variations into the time span depending on your labs and depending on the climate or the water conditions also. So I will pause this video, and after complete drying I will show what will happen on the evaporation. It has taken more time and for the complete cool. After the complete cooling of the porcelain, okay, remember, do not touch the porcelain while it is hot or while it is warm. You can see the crystals, or you can see some. Are you able to see? Yes, this is, you can see some crystals or some substances. Some substances are present on bottom of this particular porcelain. You can see it on my finger, a whitish color or dust or the particles. These are the residues of evaporation. The calculation of residue of evaporation is on the slide.
Now we will see the calculation of residue on evaporation. We have to take weight of empty porcelain dish. We will denote it as X. Then weight of porcelain dish plus water for injection. We will denote it as Y. Weight of porcelain dish plus residue after the evaporation at 105 degrees Celsius. We will denote it as Z. For taking the weight of residue, we have to subtract or reduce the X from Z, that is Z minus X, and we will get the readings. Now you have to observe the observation table. There is a test, there is a name of the test, observations and the inference. First is test for acidity, no red color, acid absent. Test for alkalinity, no blue color, alkalinity absent. Test for calcium and magnesium, no blue color, absent. Test for chloride, not change, absent. Test for sulfate, not change, absent. Test for oxidizable substances, faintly pink color remains, that is the absent. Residue on evaporation, not more than 1 milligram or the not more than standard, that is the. Now result, which test is passed and which test is failed. You can take these observations and results while conducting actual practicals. Okay, these are some experiments for conducting the online experiments. Thank you.